Good morning, students. Welcome back to Strike. Second day of this year's online class. I am very glad to meet you again through this online medium. Okay. Let us recap whatever we have discussed in the last class yesterday. In the last class, I introduced you to data structures. I told you what is the definition of a data structure. It goes like this. A data structure is a collection of elements whose organization is characterized by accessing functions that are used to store and retrieve elements from it. And I told you very clearly that whenever we talk about data structure, you should always think of some collection of elements. Some data structures are already available within a language, and some data structures are user defined. For example, arrays, structures, they are all already available in the language itself. Whereas some data structures like stack, queue, they are not available and the user has to define them. That is why they are called as user defined data structures. Since the user is defining the data structure, it is his responsibility to mention what all the various operations that can be performed on the user-defined data structures. And a user-defined data structure is made up of some primitive data type elements and other built-in data structures like arrays. Data types are of two categories, primitive data types and composite data types. Primitive data types are data types of single element values like integer, float, char, and other things. Composite data types are arrays, structures, unions, and other things. Then we discussed about one example array as a data structure. Then before discussing array as a data structure, we discussed about how to analyze a data structure. A data structure is analyzed at three levels, namely logical level, implementation level, and application level. A logical level is nothing but answering the question of what. What is the data structure is? The implementation level is answering the question how. How the data structure is implemented, and application level is where it is used. Those things that we have discussed in the last class. In addition to that, we discussed also array. What is the logical level of an array? What is the implementation level of an array? You know that array is a homogeneous collection of elements. That is, that answers the question, what? What is an array? Then in array, you are accessing values straight away, direct accessing. Example, given array sum having a size of 50, then sum of 10 can be accessed straight away. Sum of 25 can be accessed straight away like this. So values can be placed in, values can be retrieved out from that array straight away. These are the operations that we are performing, but we don't know how a value is placed in the location sum of 10. How your value is picked up from the sum of 25 further. We are not aware of all those things, but later we discussed about the formula of reaching a particular index of an array. An array name is associated with a base address, size, so base address is usually the compiler will decide, the operating system will decide, and size of the array name is depends on what type of values are to be kept within that array. These things we have discussed in the last class. Now, We are going on to our user-defined data structures like stacks, queues, list, tree, binary search tree, graphs, and other things. We are going to implement all these user-defined data structures using object-oriented technique in C++ language. Since you people are familiar only with C language, I want you to be aware of what is a class, what is an object, and those things that you should know before we can go for the implementation of our user-defined data structures like stack and queues and other things. That's what I plan to do in this class. In this class, I'm going to expose you to what is a class, what is an object, and how to define a class, how to declare an object. Those things we are going to discuss in today's class. But this class is very, very fundamental for you to understand the implementation of our user-defined data structures that we are going to discuss in the coming classes. So I want you to pay maximum attention in this class. If you have any doubts, feel free to approach me through online medium or through WhatsApp to clarify your doubts. Okay, now we pass on, now we go to the object-oriented concepts in C++. The name C++ itself says that it has something more than the C language. C language doesn't support object orientation straight away, whereas C++ language supports object-oriented concepts. Oops. From hereafter, you will study more of object-oriented approaches. In the next semester, you will study about Java language. It is a purely an object-oriented language. And later in the third year, you will study about JavaScripts and other things. There you will know more about object orientation. So you should have a clear idea of what is a class is, what is a object orientation is, everything. Now, what is this object-oriented programming? This is a methodology to design a program using classes and objects. So you should know what is a class. I used to very often tell our students that a class is basically a user-defined data type. User-defined data type. You should know what is a user-defined data type. See, there are some built-in data types like integer, character, float. These things are there in our languages. And for example, you take integer language in C language, integer data type in C language. There you, the operations that you can perform on the integer data types are addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and these are the operations that you can perform, and these are already defined within the language itself. So you don't have to specifically define those operations for the integer data type. Same is the case with the float data type. Whereas when you define your own user-defined data type, it is your duty to mention the operations that can be performed in the data type. Just now I said that a class is nothing but a user-defined data type. That means once you design a class, once you define a class, it is your duty to tell what are the operations that can be performed in that class data type. Not only mentioning them, you have to implement all those operations. For that only we are having a structure for class. So an object-oriented programming involves classes and objects. There are many benefits of this object-oriented programming. It simplifies many of our logic. So whatever the programming strategy that we have followed in C language, they are all procedure-oriented approach. Okay. In the object-oriented approach, we have more flexibility and more clarity, and it has its own other benefits like reusability, reduction of the code, easy to read the program. Many facilities are there. So some of the object-oriented concepts are inheritance, polymorphism, abstraction, encapsulation, these things. And I won't be using much of this inheritance and the polymorphism, abstraction, and encapsulation for the implementation of our stack, queues, and other things. Even if they are used, they will be used very minimally. But I will be using very often this object and the class. And also, we are going to use very extensively the pointer concepts in C++ language. And so these things you should be very familiar with: what is an object, what is a class, and what is a pointer, how it is used in the C++ language. Then only you will be in a position to understand the implementation of stacks, queues, and other concepts. So when there is a class, there is a concept of inheritance. Inheritance is nothing but class can have its own child class, and a child class can inherit the properties of the parent class. That is inheritance that you will discuss, you will understand more in other classes. And polymorphism is the ability of a function in a class having a single name and performing multiple operations. That is a function name with different signatures is called polymorphism. Okay, so how they differ, function name might be same, but the parameters might be differ. Their data types might be differ, and their return type might be differ. That is called polymorphism. That you will discuss in the language C++, but not much in our data structure. Okay, next we pass on to subsequent ideas now. As I said now, a class in C++ is a building block that is used for object-oriented programming. And as I said now, it is a user-defined data type. I give you some example, real-life examples of a class. You take our pet animal, dog. If I say dog as a class, I say it has properties and functions. What are the properties of the dog? Color of the dog, breed name of the dog, weight of the dog. These are all the properties of the dog as a class. What are the functions of that dog as a class? Your dog can bark. Your dog can chase a thief. Your dog can run fast. These are all the functions of a dog. So if I say dog as a class, name of the color of the dog, height of the dog, weight of the dog, they are all properties. And the operations are, functions are, it can bark, it can run, it can chase a thief. These things are the functions of the dog. dog as a class. Another example, car. If you treat car as a class, then what are the properties of that class? Color of that car, price of that car, year of manufacturing, petrol capacity in the tank. These are all the properties of that car. And what is that functions or operations in that car as a class? That is behavior. What is the mileage the car can give? What is the speed limit? These are all the behavior of the class. So when you go for a real life example of a class, it has a property and behavior. Behavior or function or operation all are same. So such a class we are going to define in our user defined data types. Okay. Now coming to object. When you define a class, no memory is reserved for that class. A class without an object is meaningless. Don't get confused over what is an object is. Just to recall how you declare a variable in our C language. What is the syntax of declaring a variable in C language? For example, integer variable. How do you declare it? Int variable name. That is the syntax. That is example, int x semicolon. This x is a variable of type integer. Just to understand this object as a variable. Object as a variable. When class is used as a user defined data type, then for that user defined data type, a variables can be declared. That variable is nothing but an object. So simply saying an object is an instance of a class. It is a variable of the user defined data type class. So simple. Only when the object is declared for a class, the memory reservation for that class occurs. The compiler will start allocating memory for that class only when the object is declared for that class. So an object is an instance of that class. Now you see how to define a class. Here, there's a specific syntax of defining a class. You should use the keyword class followed by name of the class. This class name is a user defined name. What is that user defined name? Identifier. It is an identifier. That is, you can give any name you want. You can give any name, but the name should be somewhat relevant to the behavior and the properties of that class. That would be convenient to you. Okay. Class follow, you should use the keyword class followed by the name of the class. Then open floor. Then access specifiers. Access specifiers are private, public, protected. These are all the access specifiers that can be supplied. I will tell you about them later. Then the data members of that class. Then the member functions. The data members are nothing but properties of that class, we can say. Attributes of that class, we can say, and other things. These member functions are, you can call them as behavior of that class, functions of that class, operations performed in that class. These are the things that you can say about member functions. When we go for an example, you will understand much about this syntax of this class. You see here, class, this is a keyword, followed by the user defined name student. So student is the name of the class, then open flower. Then here I use one access specifier public. Then there is a variable called ID, which is of type integer. Then a variable called name, which is of type string. That's all. Here in this example, okay, when you go for more other type of classes, here you can give some member functions also. Okay. Now, I said that an object is nothing but an instance of a class. Only when the object is declared, the memory for that class is given. I told you the syntax of declaring a class, that is name of the class followed by object name. That is the syntax of declaring a object. So with that understanding, you see here in the main method, I use this class name, that is student here, then followed by S1. Here, this S1 is the object of the class student. Now you recall your variable declaration in your C language. For example, you want to declare a float variable, means what you will do, you will say float, then followed by some M. Float M semicolon, then M is understood to be the float variable. Just the same syntax we are following here. Here, this is a class name, user defined class name student followed by S1. This is how you can declare an object for a class. Okay. Now, you want to access the members of this class. In this example, student has the members ID and name. If at all you want to use this ID and name outside of this class, then it should be accessed only through the object. The object here is S1, S1.id. So here I assign the value 201, 2012 ID. So the data member gets the value 201. Then S1.name, JSWAL, it is given here. Okay. Then I display the values of this ID and name belonging to the object S1. So whenever you use the data member of a class, it should be accessed only through the object. So here S1.id. Cout means it is output statement in C++ language. Just like we had a printf in C language, here we are having cout. So cout means display the value of S1.id. Similarly, S1.name here. That is how. I will tell more about this access specifier sometime later. See, the one of the advantage of class is the data protection. When your data member is declared as a private, the data value of the data member cannot be damaged outside of that class. If your data member is declared as a private access specifier, with a private access specifier, then the data member can be used only within that class, not outside of the class. Even with the object of that class, the data member cannot be used outside of that class. For example, instead of public, if I had mentioned as private colon, then int id string name is, then id and name can be used only within this class, not outside of that class. Okay. Here, since this ID and name are declared as public, they are available outside of this one. But I don't encourage this kind of public access specifier for data members or instance variables of that class. Very often I will be using the word instance variable in my future lectures. An instance variable is nothing but variables that are declared within a class. Variables that are declared within a class are instance variables. That I want you to know. Okay. Sometimes I will use the name data members. Sometimes I will use the name instance variables like that. So you should not get confused whether data member is different from instance variable. Both are same only. That you should know. Next, we go for another example. Here it is somewhat different. Okay. Here also I am having a class student. Then the access specifier here is public. Int id string name. See, before I forget, I tell you one thing. If I don't mention it as public, then by default this will be understood to be private, or either this int id and name will be understood to be private. But usually we have all the member functions as public. The member functions must be available outside of that class so that we can use that class. So by having it within a class, it won't be of any use. So we used to define this member functions as public. So here it has been used as public, insert and display. See, what is the syntax of this member function? Data type, name of the function, then formal parameters, then open flare, then the instance variable ID is given a value, name is given a value, and that's all. These things are performed within this insert. Then there is another member function, display. What it does, it displays the value ID and name. That's all. So in this class, we have defined not only two data instance variables, but also we have defined two member functions. Now, how these member functions are going to be used? Now you come to the main here. It is student. Class name, the object S1, then another object S2 for the student. Here what I say, S1 dot insert. So if at all you want to access this insert, it should be accessed only through S1, object S1, S1 dot insert. Insert has two formal parameters, I and string. The values for this I and N should be supplied here. So 201, this 201 is given to this variable I, and this name, so no, is given to the string variable N. So 201 is assigned to I, so no is assigned to N. Next, here you see object S2 dot insert 202 is given to I, Nagul is given to N. Next, I call this member function display using the object here, S1 dot display, S2 dot display. Okay, so that is how you access the member functions of your class using a object. Here is yet another example. The class name is employee. The instance variables are ID, name, salary. I have one member function called insert with the formal parameters I, N, S. ID is given the value of I, name is given the value of N, salary is given the value of S. Then I have another member function, display. I display what is this ID, name, and salary, and everything here. Then main. In the main method, what I do, I declare an object E1 for the class, employee. Another object E2 for the class, employee. Then this insert member function is accessed using the object E1.insert. What are the value? 201, Sono, and this value. They are all inserted. Then for the object E2, another insert mechanism. Okay, E2.insert, this one here. Then E1.display, E2.display. You see here, the class is same, but different objects are created, E1, E2. Okay. We will discuss more about these classes and objects in the coming classes. Okay. So I want you to come well prepared for this class at your home. And there are many books are available that explains you about class concepts. So come prepared for tomorrow's class. Okay, we will see you tomorrow. Bye.